30-odd minutes is sponsored in part by Digital Dowsing. Who are you powered by?
For the next 30 minutes, we will explore the unexplained. From mysteries beyond our galaxy to ghostly phenomena in our own backyard, we will dive into our psychic abilities and explore everything from conspiracies to the just plain weird. Welcome to 30-odd minutes. If the truth is out there, we will find it. But only by sheer accident.
Oh! That's the sweet spot on that one.
That was a good one. Where are we?
Looks like Lubuntun, Belize.
Mayan ruins. Huh. Could we be talking about maybe crystal skulls?
Ooh, possibly.
I know. I'm excited. Hey, Andrew, tell me. Of all the Indiana Jones movies you've seen, what's your least favorite? Be honest.
Least favorite? I'd have to say the last one.
Which was?
Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skulls. Something like that. I don't
Kingdom
even
Kingdom
really
of the matter. Crystal
Skulls. See, I really don't even remember it. It kind of left me.
There it is. But great topic, right?
Oh, yeah.
Poorly done movie. But great topic.
I was looking forward to it because of the topic.
And it's totally gone mainstream. That movie came out in 2008. And do you know what came out in 2007?
No.
Crystal Skull Vodka.
Oh!
Crystal Head Vodka, rather, by Dan Aykroyd. Aykroyd put that out. And, of course, so you know it's mainstream when Dan Aykroyd is branding vodka, filtered through diamonds, no less, and movies and things like that. It's popular culture, but we're going to be exploring that tonight. I'm very excited because it's a topic I know very little about.
Yeah, I'm not too versed in it myself. A little bit.
I know some of the legends. We'll talk about that. But Dr. Dreck, I asked him, I said, what do you know about crystal skulls? He actually has one. Check this out.
Greetings, oddballs. Dr. Dreck here. We're talking about crystal skulls. And, well, you know, I couldn't afford to get one of the big ones, the life-size ones. But I managed to find this little crystal guy right here. He was only a quarter, and he's guaranteed to talk. So he's going to tell me stuff. I'm putting him right here on the table, and I'm going to see what he says. Okay, say something to me.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Gorilla.
Gorilla who?
Gorilla Burger, I've got the buns.
All right, I don't want to hear stupid knock-knock jokes. Say something significant, will you?
Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Amish.
Amish who?
You're not a shoe.
Knock it off with the knock-knocks, huh? Say something good.
Knock-knock.
The last time. Who's there?
Wooden shoe.
Wooden shoe who?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Why? Well, I wish you had eyes that I could boing. Well, I'm putting this back in the bubblegum machine I got it out of.
Have you noticed that guy knows a little something about everything?
Yeah, but at least he's not alone down there.
No, he's got his crystal skull and the voices in his head. Thank you, Dr. Dreck. We appreciate it. All right, let's get to this. You ready?
Yeah, I'm all set.
Tonight's mission, crystal skulls. They're a topic that's been popularized in movies, television, and popular culture. But where do they come from? What's the purpose? Are they a relic from ancient civilization, a gift from extraterrestrials, or simply a way to focus our psychic energies? Tonight, we'll explore it all with a crystal skull guardian and researcher. Our guest has degrees in biology, chemistry, and metaphysical sciences. She's a crystal therapist and quantum touch practitioner who owns Rising Lotus Wellness Center in Woonsocket, Rhode Island, and Magick, LLC. You've seen her on the Travel Channel's Greatest Mysteries Smithsonian and heard her on radio programs discussing crystal skulls, and tonight, she's been abducted by the mothership. She's our prisoner. Please welcome Nicole Lahousse.
Hey!
Hey!
Thanks for being our prisoner tonight.
Thanks for having me aboard the mothership.
That's so cool. Welcome aboard. And I said, you're our prisoner. That's mixed messages. We're already off to we have to be consistent. Well, you've learned. Good cop, bad cop.
Well, I'm glad I was abducted in my very stylish crystal skull vodka shirt.
I know. Dan Aykroyd, who I'm sure is watching, is going to be thrilled for the plug. So let's start. Let's go back all the way to the 1920s. Lubuntun, Belize, right behind us here.
Yes.
Let's talk about one of the first skulls that really rose to prominence, the Mitchell-Hedges skull. What do you know about, what can you tell us about this skull?
Well, the Mitchell-Hedges is probably the most popular of the ancient skulls. It probably is the one that actually set everything in motion because of F Mitchell-Hedges and right. his daughter, his adopted daughter, Anna. She actually found the skull when they were on an excavation to Lubantun in Belize and the Mayan ruins and all of that. And it was found, you know, there's some things about, you know, whether it was found in her 15th or 16th year.
Right.
But her 16th birthday is believed when they actually excavated it up.
And I understand, too, I've read one study had talked about that they believed it was carved over centuries, like, you know, this slow, steady process. And then another that said, no, this is a mid-19th century production of some kind. Where do you stand on it?
Well, if you take a look at the different skulls that are out there, new, old, ancient, they all have different qualities to them. And mm-hmm. if you look, the newer skulls are carved with, you know, diamond instruments. And the old skulls are carved with some other instruments, older tools. So you see more jagged marks and things like that.
Gotcha. So do you think that it is, the Hedges skull is an old skull? Do you think it is as old as they claim, or do you think it was a Victorian contrivance?
I believe that that one is definitely an ancient skull that was found.
Right, and by some accounts, it's upwards of 12,000 years old,
yeah.
if you believe that. Now, the thing is, you can't carbon date quartz,
no.
So it's not like something else where you could just test this. Now, what's interesting to me is there's various theories. There was an Ancient Aliens episode, which
yes.
I know they can be loosey-goosey with the
yep,
facts,
yep,
you know?
Yep.
And everything has to be an alien anyway.
Yeah,
you know? But
yeah.
So one theory is that this is a gift from aliens to the Mayans. Another theory is that the Mayans developed these things. I've heard another that there's 13 of them, 13
yes.
ancient skulls. And let's put it all out there and take it one at a time. Let's start with the aliens, because we are indeed on a spaceship, and we are aliens ourselves.
Right.
I don't recall doing it. Do you?
No.
It
no.
wasn't us.
No.
If it might have been someone
else. I
was smarter.
Right. Who was it?
They were smarter.
Well, ouch. It's like she knows us. It's so weird. Okay, whatever. I don't know how many spaceships you've been on before.
So many. But the theory with the aliens is, well, I might have a little bit of a different stance with that because, you know, there is a theory that aliens have, you know, gifted humans with crystal skulls.
Right.
And I'm not sure how much I, you know, put validation into that whole theory, as much as I would love to believe that. But I think that there's something a little bit more intricate about it, where maybe the aliens, you know, or beings have actually given us the tools or the know-how to
right.
do this without such tools that we need today.
But it seems like we don't know a lot about what these things were used for centuries, even millennia
yeah,
ago.
Yeah.
Are there any theories? You know, did the Mayans leave any writing behind about what they were meant for?
Well, they used them in their rituals. They used them as recorders. They carried around wherever they went to keep a record of all of their actions, all of the interesting thing that happened, all of their rituals. They also used them in healing. So same thing with Native American lore. They use the crystal skulls with healing. And that's what's widely used today as well. Healing, meditation, things like that. But if you take a look at the amplification of what quartz does and putting intentions in there and then amplifying it that way, you see that that's how they can be used to amplify the consciousness and raise the consciousness of, you know, the whole
right.
the whole world.
And we're definitely going to get into the idea of crystals and things like that in just a minute, for sure. But I want to, last spring,
mm-hmm.
I was actually, I visited some Mayan ruins in Cozumel. I was at the Temple of the Hands. And I noticed, there's a red
yeah.
hand print. And so I noticed every little tourist stop had these skulls everywhere in Mexico, these Mexican skulls. In Central America, the skull art, there's an example
yeah.
of stuff that you'd see, just, you know, stuff like that everywhere. So skulls are very prominent in this part of the world, the Mexican Day of the Dead and,
right.
and so on. What is the fascination with skulls down there? I mean, I'm kind of afraid of them. They're scary to me.
Well, they're actually a celebration of life, so, you know, through the ancestors and the living. So when you take a look at what the skull actually represents, it is the life, not the death. So
please don't take my skull out when I die. Just leave it in there.
Well, no, we're going to make a shrunken head of you.
Fair enough. No, okay. So let's get to, now I know you do psychic work, intuitive work, you do aura readings and aura photography, all kinds of things like that. How do crystals enhance, let's just talk general crystals before we get to the crystal skulls. How do crystals in general enhance our psychic ability or, you know, the energies around us?
Well, the crystals themselves, they can help us to tune on in to our own subconscious. And when you tap into other layers of your consciousness, the astral realm and beyond, basically what you're doing is tapping into something outside of the physical body. And kind of what I mentioned with the whole utilizing the crystals and doing meditations and things like that, and if there are other people that are involved, where two or more are gathered, something along that line, you can actually access that astral realm and do astral psychokinesis. And when you do that, you're changing the matter. So you're changing what's happening in the world through that, which I think is really fascinating because it does work.
Well, I'll tell you a real quick story. Mm-hmm. I was at a shop with a guy I knew that collected minerals and crystals and things. And the guy had a shipment come in from Peru of quartz crystals, and he had a basket of broken ones there for like a dollar a piece. And the guy, Sal, goes, "Oh, Andrew, just take some. Go ahead." And I put them in my top pocket. Driving home, quietly driving down the highway, and all of a sudden, in my mind's eye, I saw the vivid picture of the local police raiding my apartment building. And then it was gone, and I'm thinking, why did I just have that vivid thought and idea? As soon as my friend dropped me off, first thing out of my girlfriend's mouth, "Oh my God, hon, the entire police department was here raiding the place. They were looking for a guy who used to live across the way." And the way she described it was exactly the way I saw it, and I have no explanation except maybe those crystals in my pocket. Weird story, but it actually happened to me.
So I know, Andrew, you've worked with Nicole on paranormal investigations.
Yes.
Brought her in as an intuitive, right?
Yes.
Give us an example of how she is out in the field.
Well, we've had three cases over the last 2 months, and they all involved families with young children, and they were all basically of the same age. There was basically a three-year-old and an eight-month-old, and the other was a seven and a five and an eight-month-old or a seven-month-old. Right. And the folks just had worries that in these old houses they were living in Rhode Island that they had somebody talking to their kids. The kids were having conversations in the middle of the night. They didn't like playing in certain rooms. And bringing Nicole in completely clean, she knew nothing of the case before I brought her there, and she was able to go to all the spots that the families had concerns with and retold the same stories I was told, had a chat with whoever was there bothering the kids, and in all three cases, the house has calmed down and the people have gotten in touch with us and said, "Don't know what you did, but the kids can sleep at night, they can play in their playroom, and no more closet doors opening."
So is being intuitive or psychic an integral part of working with crystals?
I don't think so, because you don't have to have your abilities amped up to be able to work with the crystals. That's a lot of times why people will start working with the crystals, is to help them unlock their gifts. So that's
right, because I mean I'm as psychic as a doorknob, and
yes.
You know, the only rocks I work with, I laid bricks in high school. Like I was building.
Hey, it's a good talent.
No, it was great. I actually really enjoyed the work, truly. But at the same time, like I never felt anything from it, other than the satisfaction of building with stone and bricks.
You are as psychic as a brick.
I am as psychic as the bricks I was working with. But when I you know, I've been in many New Age shops and things like that, and I see the crystals and the stones, and I've picked a few up, and they're interesting looking.
Yeah.
I appreciate the geology of it, the shape and stuff like that, but I don't necessarily feel anything, granted I wasn't trying to either, but what would you say to someone who's, you know, looking to get into this? How does the rock speak to you?
They speak to you in different ways, so mm-hmm. What I was going to say to you is maybe you just haven't found which crystal that you resonate with,
right,
to start working with, because sometimes people come in, they say, "I don't feel a thing," and then, you know, they start wandering around the store, and then they pick something up and they put it in their hand, and then all of a sudden they look around, "Oh, I think I feel something." You might feel a little tingle, you may feel heat, cool, just some shift in the sensation that is what you normally are feeling.
No, I get it. You know, actually, I take it back. There was one time I was shopping for a rock. It was my wife's engagement ring, and I was feeling something. It was
the price shocked the heck out of me.
And finally, one rock did speak to me. It was cubic zirconia. It really resonated. It was like $20, done.
So it gave him really sweaty palms.
Yeah. No, it did. But no, I get it. We rocks are in our lives for sure. Okay, yes. Nicole, hang with us a minute. We have to take a break from the news, and then we're going to come back, and I want to talk about your crystal skulls that you brought with us here tonight.
Okay.
We'll be back right after the news.
A 48-year-old teaching assistant from Birmingham, England, may have captured the image of a ghost at Alcatraz Prison. Sheila Sillery Walsh and her boyfriend, Paul Rice, were visiting the San Francisco Bay Area when they decided to take a tour of the old penitentiary, which has been a popular tourist attraction for some time now. It is also supposed to be very haunted. While taking a pre-recorded audio tour of the building, Sheila took a photograph with her iPhone of a small window that once separated convicts from any visitors who were allowed to see them. When she checked the picture on the cell phone screen, she found the clear image of a woman looking back at her through the visitor's window. The couple looked to see if anyone was truly there in the other room, but no one was found. Sheila later said, "From that point onwards, I wasn't interested in the Alcatraz tour anymore. I just kept looking at the picture over and over again." Both of them say they had no belief in ghosts before this happened, but now feel differently since capturing this image. Some who have looked at the picture think the woman is dressed in fashions of the late 1930s or early 1940s. If this is a ghost, one can only wonder why she is haunting the prison. An interesting observation made by the British couple was that right before the photo was taken, the audio tour played comments made by a woman who used to visit the prison. I'm Andrew Lake, and oddly enough, that's the news.
Thank you, Andrew. We're back. We're talking about crystal skulls with Nicole Lahousse. And that picture taken in Alcatraz, it's pretty perfect.
I know, but I find it difficult to understand how they could have faked it right then and there in the prison. I mean, they showed it to the people at Alcatraz that day when they took it. And, I mean, if it's a hoax, it's a very clever one.
What did you think, Nicole?
Very interesting. I'd like to see that up close.
Yeah, you know, working on Ghost Adventures, we did an episode on Alcatraz, and that island was used as a refugee for refugees during one of the earthquakes and fires and things like that. So there were women and children and families living on the island. It wasn't just men in a prison.
Right.
So so there's a long history out there as well. So that's kind of interesting.
It's strange. Just strange.
But stuff like that turns up. It makes national news, and we all start talking about Alcatraz again. Here's the thing. Here's my thoughts on the paranormal in general, that we don't have the answers, but the discussion is critical. And having the discussion is great. And stuff like that gets us all talking and saying, I don't know, it's too perfect. I don't know, it's this. I don't know, it's that. And I think all I can say is, imagine it was you. You're in Alcatraz. You're clicking pictures with your phone like we all do.
Right.
And you go, wait a minute. You know, that wasn't there.
Yeah.
It freaks you out.
Yeah.
It freaks you out. So imagine you're walking through the forest or walking into some kind of shop that sells crystals, and one literally speaks to you. And I understand crystal skulls have been known to speak to you. Nicole, you brought some with you today.
Yes.
Please introduce us to your friends.
Well, we have the large life-size one is Soma. The citrine one is Gemma. And the fluorite one is Raji.
They couldn't be Bob, Doug, and Dave, right? That wouldn't work. Okay, so tell us about these. First of all, how did you acquire these? Are these modern skulls?
These are modern skulls, and I actually deal crystal skulls, so I get them from all different people around the world, different carvers I work with, or different distributors as well.
Okay.
So all of these came from different sources, and this one right here came to me a while back, and she's been with me and has gone to different, you know, crystal skull conferences, met with different ancients, things like that, that she's really collected a lot of great energies. We too were at Cozumel, but we went to the Temple of Ishel.
Okay.
And so we went to the whole San Gervasio
site. Mm-hmm.
So we traversed all through there, but we had some really cool encounters, at the Temple of Ishel.
Did anyone stop you walking
around?
Yeah,
I was just going to ask that. Yeah.
There was a whole group of us, so we probably looked like a huge cult.
That's so funny.
And I think that they're used to that over there.
Oh, and I remember one of my guides, Alejandro, he was great, and we were talking about like the History Channel and stuff, talking about how all the Mayans disappeared, yep. And I remember him saying to me, you go home and you tell them, the Mayans didn't disappear. You met Alejandro. Yeah. I'm a Mayan, you know. Yeah. I'm a descendant. He said, you know, things got bad on the island. We went to the mainland. You know, we're still around.
Right,
we're just,
right,
you know.
Right.
And so, of course, they don't vanish mysteriously. They just, cultures take over and old ways disappear.
Right.
But so this skull, now I understand, I heard in another interview that you've done that this skull literally speaks to you.
Yes.
And tell us about that. What's the first time you actually hear something from it?
You hear different things. They all seem to have their own personalities, mm-hmm. so they can be really chatterboxy or they can be pretty quiet. So Raji's actually pretty quiet, but he's more of a mental prioritizer. You know, he helps you with that mental clarity. With Soma, she's very much with bringing new knowledge, bringing healing, and helping me work with other people as well. And the Citrine one is, you know, she's about abundance. So she's actually brought about some really cool, abundant mini miracles. So,
And I understand, too, you were raised a pretty strict Christian background, correct?
Yes.
And so what does your family think about you being on a spaceship talking about skulls that talk to you?
They don't really think too much of it.
Yeah.
They're not.
Yeah.
Is that a tough situation?
It is a little bit.
Yeah.
But, you know, we all love each other anyway.
They'd rather eat bread and pretend it's a human from 2,000 years ago?
Oh, Nicole, why are you doing this?
That's fine.
I get that. So.
The thing is, if you look at any belief system, it's insane.
Yeah.
Anyone,
you could tear them all down.
If it's completely foreign to you, it's ludicrous to think, like, wait, you're eating a little piece of bread and that's the body of someone who's been dead for 2,000 years? That's disgusting.
Yeah.
You know, like, or, you know, you don't eat for a month during daylight? What's wrong with you? There's grocery stores everywhere. You know, all of it's insane until you believe in it, until it becomes part of who you are and it's your belief system and it works for you. Mm-hmm. And I imagine when you start working with the crystal skulls, day one is probably not as profound as day 100 or 200 or 300. So,
right.
You know, we've talked about things like spirit communication devices. And I think the analogy we've used is it's a lot like playing a musical instrument. Like, day one, you can make a sound.
Yeah.
But it's not really music yet.
That's right. You're not carrying a melody. Yeah.
Right. So, right. So how do you continue to work with these crystal skulls to get, you know, profound results?
Usually you see a lot of really great results. Well, I do anyway, mm-hmm. in meditation. So when I meditate with a crystal skull, I'm actually going deeper into, you know, that other layers of consciousness so that I'm able to explore out into other realms.
Do you physically touch the skull while in meditation, or is it just
sometimes,
nearby?
Sometimes I'll sit with it. Sometimes I'll hold it. Other times, you know, if it's just facing me and I do my thing. I don't really have my eyes open when I'm meditating, so everything just kind of flows through, and I'm very visual when I go into my meditations, so I see a lot of things.
That's what I was just going to ask you. It's more images, and then you have to interpret what the images are?
Right. So I also hear things as well, but it's not like... It's not usually as we speak. There's
it's
more of that telepathic kind of conversation. Yes.
And what is an example of a message that you would get from Soma?
Well, with working with my crystal skulls, when I first got one, that one told me that there would be others. And I was kind of like, what? Because I wasn't used to working with crystal skulls or anything like that, or familiar with them. And then as my meditation started unfolding, all these different things started showing me what was going to be happening. I just wrote everything down because I couldn't believe it. It was just too far out there. And now if I look back, I'm so much closer to where these things that are going to be taking place in the future. But some things have already come to pass. Many things. I've seen things a lot of times 2 years out, and like with Soma, she's shown me the different things with working with the crystal skulls and working with people and working with children, and a lot of that stuff is starting to solidify a little bit more now. I understand some of the path that is laid out before me that I didn't understand before.
Is it usually your path, or does it involve the world path?
Both.
Both, okay.
Yeah.
So have you seen or been shown anything that, like, makes you want to run for the hills, or?
No.
More importantly, anything about us?
Yeah.
Not at all.
Are you here to warn us about anything?
Yes.
I might be.
Check the exhaust system on the ship.
Yeah.
You have to check your lines.
We crash every week. But any landing you can walk away from.
You need more quartz.
We do. We probably do. Dilithium crystals.
Yes, they're hard to come by, though.
Very Star Trek. But but quartz, yeah. So, and quartz, we find it all around. I mean, it's in the woods. It's everywhere. It's all around us. And I know this sounds really, all this stuff sounds really far-fetched to some people that might be watching, but is it that weird to think about magnetic tapes, recording music or recording video in your cameras?
That still amazes me, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, and so one of the things we've talked about in the ghostly realm, the stone tape theory, the idea that an environment, especially, rock with high metallic content, might truly absorb and record some kind of psychic energy, that a crime, a murder, a suicide, happiness, joy, sadness, all of that stuff might literally soak into the environment to the point where we're able to read it. So, fascinating. Just say it, Matt. We don't.
Screen. It's an LCD, liquid crystal display.
Thank you, Matt. Liquid crystal display. Matt in the engine room.
Something I was showing about the crystals that I had in my pocket that night, that weird thing happened.
Yeah.
Went into a dark room and I took the two broken ends with the terminated ends out, and in the dark room, rubbing them together, you could actually see energy go through the crystals.
Right.
I mean, that itself I found hard to understand.
Physioelectricity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So folks may be watching this on a liquid crystal display. They are indeed getting messages. Literally, right now.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
through rock. Through,
and it is
through
of crystals, a paranormal nature.
That's right. So it's not that weird. It's happening right now. Go ahead and touch the screen.
The screen. You'll feel a little charge when you touch it, too.
And if you go to our website, you can buy T-shirts and donate to it.
Yeah, that's true.
That's an important message, too. Did you know, Andrew, that all of our past episodes are on 30oddminutes.com?
Yes, I did know that.
For free?
Yes, I did.
And on iTunes?
Cool. It is pretty
and
cool.
And YouTube? Even the bad ones where things go horribly
Well, the bad
wrong,
ones can be good.
They can be wildly entertaining to look back.
I've gotten communications that people enjoy them.
That is right. All right, well, Nicole, may I hold one of these babies?
Sure, which one would you like?
One that you don't mind me dropping. I'm not intentionally going to drop it, but the one you care about the least.
You can't hold any of them.
Okay. You don't have anything that I...
Which one would you like to hold?
All right.
Just don't drop it.
The big one.
I won't drop it. Oh, my gosh. It's heavy. This is like a bowling ball.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
Actually, her head is the same size as my head.
Question for you. Do you know who carved it? Do you know who the carver was?
This one particularly, no, I don't know that carver personally.
All right.
I worked with
And country of origin?
There's certain people that... The crystal is from Brazil, carved in China.
All right.
But there are certain carvers that will only work with certain distributors, and I think that makes sense because of communication issues.
Right. May I have one of these forever to keep?
You can have this one.
Oh.
This one we brought for you.
Oh.
And someone
hang
was
out
charging
with
it up.
Look at that. Yeah. I think mine's smaller than Dreck.
Can
you hold
Dreck's.
That? Thank you so much. All right, so what do you have coming up? You're a keeper of the skulls. What's coming up for the Guardians?
Well, we do have a really special day that's coming up in November.
Okay.
And this is all about, it's called Crystal Skulls World Day, and that's put together by a Crystal Skulls World Council. And those are the people that they're kind of staying anonymous because of the fact that they want it to be unbiased and just all inclusive. They don't want to be exploited as these are the people that are doing this. They just want it to be a world event. So I think that's really cool and how that's unfolding. And I'm a co-sponsor of that.
Excellent.
So I actually donated some skulls for raffle that have also gone to the San Gervasio site and have been at the 12-12-12 Mayan ceremony.
Excellent.
As well.
Awesome.
But you can see that at crystalskullworldday.com.
Awesome. Well, we'll put links to it from our website.
Yes.
Nicole, thank you
great.
For coming
thank
aboard
you.
The mothership as our prisoner. And we will, of course, free
Guest.
You back into the world.
thanks
so much for talking about crystal skulls, bringing some of your friends with us, and thank you for this little guy. Folks, until next time, stay odd. Okay.
We'll be right back.